Hello, everybody. How's everybody doing? Great? Great? Yeah. So who wants to stay alive? Yeah.
Okay. Oh, no, I'll take you.
So, I don't know if I may, through, I'm a scientist, by the way, my name is Ernesto. I'm going to try and synthesize the main constraints for living beings to remain on this planet. So it's clearly not an easy task. It's an honor to have you on the film. And there are, of course, time limitations also. This is a very good exercise, by the way. A very good exercise to compress what you know or think you know on a subject in just 30 minutes. It's a terrific exercise. So what do we know? Do we have a walking mic? Can I use one of those? So I don't. That's enough constraining for one. Yeah, thank you. So, what do we know about the actual limits to life? So, one of the things we have noticed, this is, you know, Gompers, Benjamin Gompers, right? Oh, yeah. So, this is an actuary. He discovered this general law, which is, don't kill the messenger. The probability of dying doubles every 8.4 years after you're, 13 years old. So from puberty on, the probability of dying doubles. It's not a good thing. It's until right about you become 85, in which the probability of dying remains constant. That's a good thing, but we need to get there first. So we know this. We know it is increasingly more and more difficult to remain alive once, you're born. We also know this Hayflick limit. Hayflick's limit, Leonard Hayflick? Please raise your hand. You know Hayflick? So, I'm not alone here. So, Leonard Hayflick noted that there's an actual limit to the amount of replications our cells can endure. It's 40 to 60 for humans. This is, of course, this telomere length. Who knows a telomere story? So everybody. So I have this thing here. Maybe so. It's for the ones which are not, initiated. Telomeres are like this. Oh, what's the camera guy? Yeah. Can you focus this maybe for later? Now, anyways, this is a plastic wrapping on your laces for them not to, destroy themselves. So each replication. Keep my telomere safe. So each replication shortens your telomeres, and even if everything goes smoothly, at some point you just stop replicating. That triggers cell death and you're done. Right. So there's a technical limit to the radical extension of lifespan. That's neither a good piece of news. But anyways, this is one. The one solid thing we have in biogenontology is that extreme caloric restriction, as the doctor showed, actually increases lifespan. But this is really hard. Now, if you notice in his table, it said up to 65% calorie deprivation. That's a lot of hunger. From T-sex on, T-sex, we call T-sex the age of sexual maturity. You can start depriving your laboratory animals from, half of what they eat. That's tough. That's really tough. The control group eats freely. We call that ad libitum. They eat whatever they want. And, the results are conspicuous for everyone to see. Am I going too fast?
No.
Yeah, it's bad. Life is great. I want to do a lot of it before I go out. I must. Yeah, I'm good. So, what else do we know? Is it applicable though? So I've been, you're probably aware of certain publications concerning, you know, fruit flies or worms or even little mice. So is it applicable to humans? Who has heard of Kleber's law, the law of three quarters? Please laugh. No, okay, so, anyways, so maybe it's summarizing. I didn't put a slide for that. It's metabolic rate is proportional to the mass of the animal, elevated to the power of three quarters, that's 0.75. What that means is little animals have huge, fast metabolisms, and we bigger animals have slower metabolisms, like an elephant or a whale. So what are the problems with that? The inapplicability of what the research have found in little species to our species, right? So what works for mice, who practices intermittent fasting? Yeah. Some of you know, yeah. Well, I'm sad to say that the autophagy results we all saw in mice or little animals do not apply to humans. If you just, you know, remove your dinner or just you do whatever 16:2:8, all nut, 1 meal a day. So we need stronger, deeper, much tougher, like deep fasting calorie restriction for that to be applicable to humans. Right. What else do we know? We know that caloric restriction, being the gold standard of biogerontology, just doesn't work if you inhibit, like pharmacologically inhibit autophagy. This is Yoshinori Osumi. Osumi-san. This is a Nobel Prize winner, I think it's 2016, I think it is, for just 30 years of work on autophagy. A fabulous, fabulous phenomenon. So what else do we know? We know, this is a very early observation in biogerontology, we know that the more intense the rate of living, the shorter the duration of life. This is called, the rate of living, which is, and I summarize it in a little mathematical expression I'll show you in a minute, but this maximum lifespan is inversely correlated with energy expenditure. Go to the L rule, not the one you remember from high school. The L rule. So the higher the expenditure, the more energy you spend during your lifespan, the shorter the duration of your life. Right? And if you somehow, artificially or whatever, you diminish the energy expenditure, you will prolong your maximum lifespan. And the difference should be made. A distinction should be made between life expectancy, which is an average. Who knows the average life expectancy of its region? We just heard that. Is that a good thing? Is that a good number? Yeah. So averages are great, but maximum lifespan, we call it L, max, is different from life expectancy at birth is very different. So we are sure we can get there. What was it? 113 years? Let's call it 99. Who should aim? Who wants to live like solid, good, strong 99 years of age? And I do. Okay, good. I'm not alone. So what are the constrictions there? Well, we have this. We have endured in the last century or so what we call a epidemiological transition. Are we good over there? Yeah, we're good? Excited to live 99 years of age? Good. So this epidemiological transition simply means that we used to die massively of, you know, hunger, freezing these infectious diseases, and now we get cancer, we get, you know, heart attacks, you know the sad song. So we need to, it's like a minefield. We need to get there. So this is my expression of this law. L-max, so maximum longevity, is inversely correlated to energy expenditure. Hence, caloric restriction seems to improve the odds of you remaining alive. But how much? Like, we scientists think in terms of quantitatively, we think. So, how much should I restrict my calories? And is it applicable to humans? So, the thing appears to be autophagy. And you can get to autophagy through several routes. Okay? So, the other thing we know, is, well, there's this phenomenon of increasing entropy. Like your DNA, the package of instructions gets messier and messier, disorder. Who remembers the laws of thermodynamics? Almost everybody. Okay, do you, sir? Do you recall the second law of thermodynamics? You do? Okay. Guys, we should be paying attention to this. It states, you know, the first law is energy isn't created or destroyed, it's transformed. We remember that. Now you remember. And the second says, every system, including us, every system sinks, okay? Slips into an energy, a state of minimum energy and maximum disorder. Minimum energy and maximum disorder. How does that sound? Like frozen chaos, right? Chaos, gelato, right? So like your house after 1 month of no plan. That's a really messy thing. So a number of labs, not mine, a number of laboratories have been researching this thing and can we bring the DNA back to order through several interventions? It's a workable hypothesis. Anyways, we got this thing covered, thank you to the wonderful doctor. So the name of the game now is how do we go from life expectancy to really, really good, solid, extreme longevity. Okay, so we have two schools of thought, we can say. One group of labs thinks it's an engineering problem, meaning we should give, you know, M&M and niacin and certain, you know, NAD plus injections. Have you heard of that? Yeah, a lot of people. Thank you. So we think there's another school of thought, and we think it's essentially a thermodynamic problem, and we can also fix some things in the air. So we can do a little bit of physics and a little bit of engineering together. Who is taking some vitamin or drug with the specific aim of increasing lifespan? Okay, some of you. So, caloric restriction mimics, imitadores da restricción calórica. Okay, good, good. So, just so you know, those work, like research shows those work, the pharmaceuticals that imitate or mimic caloric restriction should be taken in the midst of true, actual fasting. And it should be congruent with what you're doing. All right. So my name, for those of you who haven't heard of me, shocking, my name is Ernesto, those who were here a bit later. Ernesto Pietro Latacos, I'm a scientist, I'm an independent scientist. Now, who have you ever heard of me before?
No.
So that's kind of depressing, but it's my fault. I promise I'll do better. I'll do better. Social media. So scientists should do a lot better communicating what they've found. Science and human knowledge should need to be applied to human endeavors right away. So one of the things we did for the last 27 years is cancer, metabolic therapy of cancer. This is a new and exciting field, it's called precision metabolic oncology. More of that in a minute. But why is it relevant? We did a bunch of experiments, and then we did translational medicine with hyperbaric chambers and whatnot. But in the midst of that research, which is relevant for us today, is we did this documentary 12 years ago called Cáncer y Civilización, En Busca de la Salud Perdida. So here, what we found out, because it was a weird, a really odd demographic, the Inuit people, the Eskimo, you know, the Inuit people, Inuit Yupik. So those guys didn't get any cancer, right until the 1920s. And I mean, no cancer at all. We went through the literature, all of it. There was no trace of cancer of any organs within the circumpolar peoples. Why is that? It was a true mystery at the beginning of the 20th century. Well, so what we did, we measured, we did the Inuit diet. We ate only raw food and liver and brains and meat and blood and all the things. We measured continually with continuous glucose monitoring, and we found out, well, why these guys didn't have cancer. They have high degree of, partial pressure of oxygen in the tissues, a lot of vitamins, very, very, very low glucose, like 63 milligrams is what the average, the mean glucose, 63 milligrams per deciliter, right? Like half. Urban mother populations. So, but one other thing didn't escape our minds. Like, these guys were the poster child of good health. Like, metabolically speaking, Inuit had the best health possible, ever. But they didn't seem to live past 60-something. You see, there was a ceiling to longevity between the Inuit, amongst the Inuit. Why is that? Why do you think that is? Does anyone have any sort of theoretical, maybe, clue? Why the Inuit people, Inuit Yupik and some other hunters, yes ma'am?
The metabolic effects higher.
Absolutely. So let us quantify that, thank you for that. How many calories do you think these guys have to go through just to endure living in the Arctic? A number? Care to throw a number? Sorry? What was that? Okay, 400. Try an order of magnitude bigger. For 1,000? It's okay. Okay, it's 7,000 calories. And this is the average, okay? 7,000 calories a day. So remember our formulation. Maximum longevity is correlated inversely with energy expenditure. Okay, that's a problem there. How do we go about living a livable life? Who wants to deprive yourself, oneself, of 60% of all the food you're gonna eat in your life? Not a good thing. Okay, so there's this thing we call escape velocity. We brought in this concept almost 30 years ago from this realm. Which is, we are eroding at a certain percentage per day. So we grow old by a certain percentage every day. We also reconstruct ourselves by a certain percentage every day. So the delta, is it negative or positive? What do you think? Slightly negative, yeah. That's why we grow old as a function of time. So at least in theory, if we can manage to have a positive delta, a positive net, decrease of entropy, theoretically, we should be getting younger as we age. Yay! So, we are growing, and we have this thing we call peak vitality, circa 23 years of age. Is anyone suffering from a non-healing wound here? Did you cut yourself 15 years ago? And you're still bleeding? No, right? So you're growing, you're healing. Cicatrización, okay, so we need to improve that and also diminish the erosion. So the mitochondria are involved, I'm not gonna bore you with that. The extracellular matrix is involved, we know this, welcome. The blood is involved, this is a marker of aging. And hemoglobin is a marker of age, biological marker of age. And also the cellularity of the bone marrow. That's a bummer. So, and this is obvious, right? This is obvious. We have sarcopenia? Sarcopenia, is that a... Okay, it's a common word. Okay. So as we go... I'm sorry, this is a... I hate it. This age is just a number. It's a word. Age is a word. Anyways, we have this little formula. You can take a picture. We need autophagy, first and foremost. Like, it's impossible through present-day technology. It is impossible to move the needle in our favor without autophagy. How do we get there? We don't have time today, but you can Google me later. We have this problem. So the super nutrition, I call this, this is the first time in human history this is possible. Like, we need to get, have you ever heard the CRON, CRON, this acronym, CRON, calorie restriction with optimal nutrition? The professor has. So how do we do that? This is the first time in history we can eat very little calories, like macronutrients, and then a bunch of vitamins, a bunch of micronutrients at the same time. And so our metabolism is not taxed with increased calories, and you get all the rejuvenation from, you know, the vitamins and whatnot. This is very complex. What I'm trying to do here, let me confess, is that I go through the Pareto analysis. You know, Pareto analysis, like 80-20 law, you know? It's more like 90-10%. You heard about it here, right? Yeah, so 80% of our effort, of our results come from maybe 20% of our efforts. So most of what we do is irrelevant. Most of what we do is irrelevant. And that's encouraging. I mean, we can save a little money on that. So we have to exercise. And that's a contradiction, right? Didn't I just say energy expenditure is inversely correlated, da da da? So if we train, we spend more energy, therefore our mind are very confused. So which one is it? Well, there's this concept of minimal effective dose of anything. And my friends, exercise is a medicine. So what is the proper dose? We need to do strength training, for sure. Hands down, full stop. Strength training, like, right? Strength. That is the thing that... So if you're above 65 and you break your bone, your hip, there's a 50% chance that you will not live another year. How's that for a depressing piece of news this morning? Oh, afternoon. Right? So we need that strength, because bone density is absolutely dependent on muscle density. Okay, so, and we have hormetic stimuli. We heard this beautiful presentation this morning about hormesis. So this thing here, this is the 20% of interventions that will give you maybe the 10% of things that could be done, but will give you 90% of the return on our money, efforts, and suffering. Fasting is kind of suffering. Yeah, right? Okay, so we need to remember for this, we need strength training. Now this is kind of funny, and it gives you nothing, I promise you, it gives you nothing. We measured this thing. We also need fasting, and by fasting, you mean deep fasting. What do you think it is? The threshold, el umbral, what do you say in Portuguese? Umbral. What do you need to, how many days do you need to fast for you to get to autophagy? How many days? At least 72 hours. At least. Like, it is impossible without ketosis, like physiological ketosis, meaning 2, 3, 4 millimoles per deciliter of ketone bodies, and a glycemic index, a glycemic level of 30 to 60, right? We need that for a number of days. And then you get autophagy. But that's when the party begins. So how many days a year? Well, there's a formula for that. Now, let me quickly state that we don't have a general, universally applicable rule for humankind. Here, in this very room, we have not one, not two, but 8 sub-phenotypes. Remember phenotype? Genotype is a library, the DNA library. We have the expression, the biological expression of that. So we have 8 sub-phenotypes. So which kind of fasting should you do? This is deep fasting, an intermittent ha-ha-boo, right? So Yeah. And millions. Oh, demos. This is a story of my life. I know it gets really good when we get into the juicy part. That's when I, sneaky, I had his mic. Thank you, sir. So, we can't do it. This is niacin, by the way, and I love it. Niacin. This is what really works, not the other. Who takes niacinamide? Would you stop? Like, it's hepatotoxic. Like, when you get to a proper, the proper pharmacological dose, it's in the order of 2 to 3 grams a day. And the amida, the pharmamidica, niacinamide, it's kind of toxic at those levels, right? So, anyways, we can do that. Let me quickly. So we need strength training, like really strength training. Deep fasting, like at least 4 times a year. Good deep dive into autophagy. Not just fasting, autophagy. And then we have, well, niacin and the, this is the poster child, the other, all the interventions we can do. All right, guys, so if you want to know more about this, just look me up on Google. This is my webpage, Ernesto Pinto de la Cos. You can read my papers relative to some other, this is not a blog, these are peer-reviewed, you know, papers in journals. And then you can also contact me. Please contact me. I'm so in LinkedIn, okay? So, we don't have time for, okay, 26, we have four minutes to spare. What would you say, if I may, sir, what would you say is the key takeaway? What impresses you more about these ideas? One idea I want to hear. The one thing you're going to take to your neighbor, to your mother-in-law. You? No? Is that a hand? No, you're scratching your head. So what is important? Yes, ma'am.
We should be moderate in everything.
Moderate in everything. Okay, what part of my presentation is moderate? Okay. I'm quite the opposite, as I would say. So this passion for life is an ingredient, would you say?
Yes.
Right, so moderate, yeah. Yes. And this is a great statement. She means moderate eating, moderate exercise. So yeah, but we need to quantify that. What exactly is the number? What exactly is the number? So there's one thing. Another idea? Anyone? Anyone? You, sir? Pharmaceutical? No? Yeah? Yes? Yes, ma'am. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, take action consistently.
Whoa!
Take action consistently. You know, if you can make them join them. So how do you do that? I would recommend that you buy, right now, some sort of journal. I use a journal for you now. And you write every day your action plan. This is my meals, this is my training, this is my... Mm-hmm. Right? All the things. Yes, what else?
I think, for me, it works better to use an app that we plan.
Okay. So, yeah, the planning thing works, but here's the thing. Man plans, God laughs. So I would say to you that you write what you actually did, okay? So guys, it's been a pleasure, it's been a privilege for me to share this with you. Do look me up on Google, and thank you so much for listening to me.